God is mighty to save. He is mighty to save forever. Author of salvation, he rose and conquered the grave. Jesus conquered the grave. When darkness seems to hide his face, I rest on his unchanging grace. In every high and stormy gale, my anchor holds within the veil.
Everyone, please remain standing for the reading of God's word. Today's reading is from Acts 4, verses 1 to 12. While Peter and John were speaking to the people, the priests and the commander of the temple guard and the Sadducees came up to them angry, because they were teaching the people and announcing in Jesus the resurrection of the dead. So they seized them and put them in jail until the next day, for it was already evening. But many of those who listened to the message believed, and the number of the men came to about 5,000. On the next day, their rulers, elders, and experts in the law came together in Jerusalem. Annas, the highest priest, was there, and Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others who were members of the high priest's family. After making Peter and John stand in their midst, they began to inquire, "By what power or by what name did you do this?" Then Peter, filled with the Holy Spirit, replied, "Rulers of the people and the elders, if we are being examined today for a good deed done to a sick man, by what means this man was healed, let it be known to all of you and to all the people of Israel that by the name of Jesus Christ the Nazarene, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, this man stands before you healthy. This Jesus is the stone that was rejected by you, the builders, that has become the cornerstone. And there is salvation in no one else, for there is no name under heaven given among people by which we must be saved." This was the reading of God's word. You may all be seated.
Good morning. I would like to ask you a favor before I start. It's hard to speak to empty chairs up here in front, especially since a lot of people are gone for the Memorial Day weekend. Would you please indulge me? I know it's a bit uncomfortable for some of you to do that, seeing you have your comfortable chairs, but would you please move forward? I want to see you up close and personal. Thank you very much. I can see Sister Ellie is taking the lead there. She told me this morning that she wasn't feeling well, and we prayed together, and looks like you're feeling better, right? Thank you very much. Just move forward. There's plenty of seats up front. I hope you don't mind, because I'd like to see your facial expression as I, perhaps you can move forward so the others will just follow at the back, okay? Thank you. And girls, would you mind going to the front? I know you're already in the front, but just to the front, very front. Thank you. And Justin, follow suit, go to the front. Thank you. Very good. Thank you very much for your indulgence. Brother June, you can do better than that. Come on. Right here, right up in front. And Sister, next to Sister Amy over there. And Paolo, I think you can run to the front if you wanted to, right? Thank you very much. Yeah, go ahead. Please. Your dad told me that people will just comply even though I didn't cordon off the back. I could have cordoned it off a while ago, but Brother Kiel said I can just make a request and you will comply most agreeably. Thank you very much. Come on. Tim, let's go. Front, please. Come on. Thank you very much. Okay, now that we're sort of ready, yes, please come to the front. Tim, I want to see you. Tim has been leading our Bible studies in Astoria for couple of sessions now, and I'm so proud of him, and I want him to learn from me. No, I'm just joking. I want him to continue that. And I recognize that some of you made that sacrifice. It's a long weekend. You didn't go out. I'm not saying the others who aren't here did the wrong thing. It's everyone to his own conscience and his own decision. So seeing that you're here, I am quite appreciative of the fact that at least half the congregation is here this morning, okay? We know that living in a changed world is a reality for all of us, right? Okay, let me try this little experiment. How many of you, let's put it at maybe 30 years ago, 30 years ago, we're not here. How many of you 30 years ago were not here? Of course, the young people will raise their hand because they weren't born yet. Please, come on, let's do a quick survey. How many of you were not here 30 years ago? Tatay Jun, were you here 30 years ago? No. So if the answer is no, okay, let me put it in a positive way. Were you here 30 years ago? Raise your hand if you're here 30 years ago. Oh, wow. We have a few. We have a few who were here 30 years ago. Could you stand up? I'm just interested to see who among you were here 30 years ago. Sister Rose, just indulge me here. Okay. How many of you were here 30 years ago? In this place, in New York. Not in this earth. In this place, here in New York. Okay. Okay. So Brother Andrew wasn't in New York. He was in? California. Okay, thank you very much. Okay, thank you very much. So the rest of you were somewhere else, right? No, you were here 30 years ago. Why didn't you stand up, Brother Nandi? Okay, so Brother Peter, come on forward. I don't want people sitting at the back, if you don't mind. Sister Elsie, how many of you were here? Okay, I don't want to put it in the negative, but how many of you were here 40 years ago? 40 years ago. One, two, only two. Okay, only two people were here in New York 40 years ago. Let's try this again. How many of you were here 50 years ago? Still the two of them. And then how many of you were here 60? Sorry, Brother Fred, we're getting to know your age. 70. Okay, so the winner, Sister Ellie, was here 70 years ago. So you weren't a native New Yorker, huh? If I were to ask you, were you here 80 years ago? No. If I asked any of you, were you here 1,000 years ago? How about 3,000 years ago? Okay. This story we have that Sister, what's her name? Bea read, right? Bea read occurred how many thousands of years ago? At least 2,000 years ago. Were you here then? Or were you there then when the story happened? Okay, you weren't there in the temple in Jerusalem 2,000 years ago. You understand that? So, we're telling you a story this morning that happened 2,000 years ago, more or less, okay? Now, let me ask you a question. I've been hearing a lot of people graduating, right? How many of you are graduated? Okay, let me try this little experiment because I want to make it really significant. How many of you graduated just a week ago? Raise your hand. Or 2 weeks. So let's make it 2 weeks ago. So, Mr. Leah and Tim, 2 weeks ago. How many of you graduated a year ago? Whatever you graduated from, whether it be college or high school or, from PhD, a year ago? 2 years ago. There you go. Brother Paolo, and I know we have a PhD. I should start calling her Dr. Olive. That's the sign of respect for all the work that she has put in, right? Okay, let me try a bigger number. How many of you graduated 10 years ago? At least 10 years ago. So from 10 years to zero. So 10 years ago up to now, you graduated. Good. How many of you graduated from 20 years ago? High school, middle school, whatever. Doesn't have to be a PhD or... Okay, let me try this. How many of you graduated from 100 years ago to now? 100 years ago to now? All of you should raise your hand because you graduated from something, right? No, from 100 years ago to now. So you're here from now to 100 years ago. The whole range. Okay, all right. I guess my question wasn't very clear. What am I trying to say? I'm trying to say that something changed in your life, correct? Something changed. Oh, welcome to Nanay Rasing. I didn't realize he's come back. Okay, welcome po. Okay, and Tatay Francisco is not with you. Okay, so that's good. Things have changed for her. Just a few days ago, she was living in the Philippines, right? And now she's here. How many of you like change? How many of you like change? Only a few? Any change? Change of clothes. Some people don't like change of clothes. They just wear the same thing. Okay. My wife and I have had a lot of changes in our life. No? Well, of course, the very first change we had was getting married, no? As a husband and wife. That's a big change. What else? We had our children. We had my first, Celine, who lives in Australia, and Therese, 6 years ago, and Celine, 33 years ago. Okay, so 26 and 33 years ago. That's a long time ago, isn't it? I remember very distinctly when my daughter, oldest daughter, was born, and indulge me in a little talk of an old man and his stories. But we were in Colorado, and my wife gave birth about past midnight. No, I can't remember if it's 2 a.m. or about 2 a.m. And I haven't had any sleep because she was, in labor. You know, she was in pain. So when my daughter was born that day, and I got out to start my car, the windshield was frozen with snow. This was in Colorado. And I said, oh no, I have no sleep. I have to go home and I can't even get into this car. But you know what? I was happy. I said, no, this is a good change. It's a good change. When my wife and I decided to immigrate to Australia, it was such a big change. We couldn't even understand the people there, no? The accent and everything. We took a train, and the announcement on the radio said, trains headed for Makata. And I go, what? Makata? And I finally figured out Makata is MacArthur, no? MacArthur. So we were in the train line going to MacArthur. And that's just the start of many, many changes since we moved from Australia back to the Philippines to teach at the University of the Philippines. And then from the Philippines, U.S. to Philippines, Philippines to Australia, Australia to the U.S. in Dallas, Dallas to New York, and here I am. No? Maybe my story doesn't resonate with your story. Maybe you have a different story of change. But people have commented to me, oh boy, do you like change? No? You enjoy change. You're still undergoing changes. You're already 63 years old and things are changing. So come October, we will have our first grandchild, God willing. And God is going to give us a big change. No? And just informing you, I think that she will be a cesarean for now, but please pray for her, okay? Now, was there a big change in the book of Acts? So, you see, these disciples were living in a changed world. And we've just started to talk about the changes that's happened because of the work of the Holy Spirit. What was the first change in Acts chapter 1 and 2? Who came? The Holy Spirit came. Remember that picture? They were filled with the Spirit, and a violent wind came and flame with tongues of fire resting on each person's head, talking in languages they haven't learned, and everyone hearing their own language. That's a big change. Last week, Pastor TJ gave you that story, which also is the change. What happened here? Peter and John healed a lame man. I don't know if you can see it clearly. Maybe we can turn off these lights. Thank you. There you go. So that's clear. No, you have... Where did these lights come from? This is the Rowena. I think it's from there. Just the top portion there. One of them. Okay. All right. So you can see here... I forget the name of the artist. This is a famous painting. You can see here the lame man. Lame from birth. He was about 40 years old. And Peter looked him in the eye. And it's a bit inaccurate. Can you see what the inaccuracy is? What's wrong with the man? Huh? When Peter said, look me in the eye, what did the lame man do? He looked. Obviously, this artist didn't read this Bible very clearly. He didn't look. Or maybe he did, but I can't tell. Maybe on the side of his face because he's so weak and he can't get up, right? Okay, so this is the healing of the lame man. How many of you remember the story? Yes. You remember the story because it was the sermon last Sunday. And the significant thing about it is, what did Peter say? Silver and gold have I none. But what I have, I give to you. What did he say? In the name of Jesus Christ, rise up and walk. And what did the man do? He jumped up, right? He leaped before he walked. He just didn't rise, he jumped up and he walked. No? And what else did he do aside from jumping up and walking? He was praising God. No? How amazing is that? That man was healed because of what? Because of the Apostle Peter saying those words like a magic statement or magic formula. In my youth, I used to use this magic formula. Open sesame! You know, I would pretend like I'm, what is it? Alibaba and the 40 thieves. That I would be in front of this curtain that we made into a tent, and I would go, open sesame! Nothing happens, of course, but I just have fun doing that. You see, those aren't magic words. Peter was able to say those words because he knew there was power in the name of Jesus to do what? To do what? Well, obviously to heal, isn't it? To heal. But you'll find out more that the man was more than just healed. The man was more than just healed. There was a change in his life. Huh? Because of the fact that he now lives in a changed world. He now lives in a changed world because Jesus Christ is the new power that makes people well. Is that clear? Peter lives in a changed world. Why? Because the old Peter became the bold Peter, proclaiming Christ. And in this chapter, you'll find out how bold he is. Huh? How he was questioned, jailed later on, and released. A changed world. In fact, he had to face a trial. Peter had to face a trial. Much like our Lord Jesus Christ faced a trial. I don't know if you could see me here. I think you have to turn on the spotlight. Can you see me? Okay, all right. No, the spotlight. Not that I want to be in spotlight, but in the cross should be prominent. Thank you very much. RJ is in a youth camp with the other college students, so our training is doing this work. Okay. Please, not these lights, because my head would start to shine. Okay. Thank you very much. Yeah, that's better. It's a panel. It's the one in front. You have to turn on with the remote. Okay, thank you, Brother Roy. Okay, anyway. Sorry for that interruption. Acts chapter 4. Turn with me there, please, because I want you to look at these key verses. All right? These key verses. Are you with me? Okay. Bea read this earlier, but I'm just going to take a few verses from it. As I'm taking Acts 4, 8 to 10, and then 12. So that should read Acts 4, 8 to 10, and 12. So after the healing, after the layman was healed, it says that the high priest Annas, Caiaphas, John, Alexander, and others who were members of the high priest's family. Sounds familiar? Philippine politics? So we have a family of rulers in Israel. Huh? Very similar to what we have in the Philippines. I say that not out of joking, but they also practiced that time because they were the ones who were in connivance with the Roman government. I said this during the prayer meeting, and those of you who are familiar with World War II, Japanese occupation of the Philippines, we have people who connived with the Japanese against the Filipinos. And we call them Makapili. Don't know if you remember your history. And usually they will be the ones with covered heads in a sackcloth with a hole in just to see. And the Japanese would say, "Who is the guerrilla among these people?" And the guy would go around and say, and the Japanese would take them off. Bang, 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 bang. Right? Now, I know that's history, but we have to learn from history. We have to know that this background is very important. Because this ruling family of Annas, Caiaphas, and we don't know who John Alexander are, but some are guessing they're part of the royal family because, or the high priest family, because it says others who are members. Okay? So that's what they're concluding. Why is this important? Because the Sadducees, they are Sadducees. It's a religious sect. It's a group which manages Jerusalem and the surrounding areas of Israel for the Roman government. So you know that Pontius Pilate called in the high priest to ask what is the problem here, right? You take care of it. But they didn't. They passed it on to Pontius Pilate. So this is a political situation, but the important thing here is this. The Sadducees, if you don't know, I'm telling you, did not believe in the resurrection. Okay? They did not believe in the resurrection of the dead. The Sadducees also did not believe that the Messiah would come as a person, let alone a person who is, from a carpenter's son. No? Poor. Riding a donkey. Instead of a stallion and a mighty horse, they think that Jesus was not the Messiah. That's the main thing, right? Okay. So when they heard that Jesus' name is being proclaimed as the way this man, this lame man, was healed, they were angry because it went against their belief, their religion. Okay, so what's the point? The point is this. If the Sadducees were in power and these people were inciting others by the name of Jesus, what do you think will happen to their power? No. Their power will be questioned, correct? Because there's a new power in town, so to speak. There's a new power in town. So they were jealous. They were angry. And I can see a lot of you who are up front are more attentive. That's good than if you are sitting at the back. Why is that important? Because when Jesus rose from the dead, when he died on the cross, when Jesus went to be with the Father and sent the Holy Spirit, there's a new order. There's a new world. Why is it a new world? Look at the question. of this high priest in the Sadducees. By what power or what name did you do this? What's in the name? Shakespeare says, arose by any other name. What? Would smell as sweet. Of course, that refers to Juliet, the love of Romeo, no? Because the name of Juliet's family name is against the... Anyway, it's a long story. And if you read the story of Romeo and Juliet, you would know the background. But is a name important? Because Shakespeare seems to make light of it. What's in the name? A rose, by any other name, would still be a rose. Correct? Except nowadays, there are many different varieties of roses, and there's so many different colors to speak from. So the rose retains its what? Its sweetness, its smell, right? Its looks. And that's what a name represents. Last prayer meeting, I will be very quick with this. I said my name in actual is not Dodie. That's my nickname. My real name is Forado. Forado. And it comes from my father's name, Fortunato, and my mother's name, Adoracion. Okay? It sounds really bad, though. Because when you put it together with Champ, because my classmates used to teach me, oh, Champ. Champorado. You get it? You know what champorado is, right? The porridge. And I was really dark then. No, you look like champorado. No, and so they would tease me. But you know, my name is distinct. My name is who identifies me. There's no other person in the whole world whose name is Forado. Why? Because I've never been stopped in an airport for having the same name as somebody else. Not like Miguel or Juan or those names. The point is this. My parents gave me that name because they want me to remember them. For is for Fortunato, Ado is Adoracion. Not only to remember them, but to tell the whole world, this is my son. We gave him a name. Correct? So the idea of my being in nature the son or the son of Forado or the son of Adoracion makes me not only unique, but my essential nature, who I am, is in that name. That's why in the Philippines, we protect our names. We protect our family's names. Don't you ever bring shame to my family name. If not, I will disown you. You can call yourself somebody else. Remember that? That is Filipino culture for you. But the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, it says. No? Why? Because the question is, by what power by what name did you do this? Did you heal the lame man? Peter answered and said, by the way, he didn't just answer. He was what? Filled with the Holy Spirit. You will see this over and over again. Peter, a changed man, because of the Holy Spirit in him, that dwells in him, the Spirit that controls him, the Spirit who gives him the power through Christ's power to make somebody well. This is what Peter said. You rulers of people and elders. It's like he's saying, yeah, you say you're rulers. Oh, yeah. Sure, you're rulers. Wait till you hear who is the real ruler. No? Is that the right expression that kids nowadays use? Sure. Call yourself that. Let's see. Whatever. No? He could have said that. But for me, I'm sorry if I'm trying to sound better to the younger generation, but that's the way they talk. And they're saying that this deed done to this sick man, Peter is saying, by what means this man was healed, is the means of making him well through Jesus' name. Let it be known to all of you that not just those people he's speaking to, not just the rulers gathered around him. By the way, the lame man probably was dead too while this is going on. Because this, Peter said, who healed, by what name did you heal this man? We don't know the lame man was also imprisoned, but we do know he was there because of that. What does it say? All of you, and to all the people of Israel, not just you. I'm making it known to everyone else that this Christ, Jesus Christ, the Nazarene, identifying him, no? Identifying him, making him distinct. Nobody else. There's no Jesus Christ of Nazarene. He was the one. You crucified. Anybody else crucified by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazarene? No. Whom God raised from the dead. Was anybody else raised from the dead aside from Christ? No. All of these are distinctive, but more than that, he is the one who raised, who healed this man. What does it say? It doesn't just say healed the man, made him walk. It says this man stands before you healthy. Did you notice that? And that's why probably this painter used that kind of pose, and this man was just limp and looks very pale and unhealthy. He can't even look Peter straight in the eye. That's what I like about it. Do you see that? And the use of light. Do you see the... joking, I'm just trying to be an artist's commentary here. But the use of the lighting focuses on him. Right? Notice it's on him, not even on Peter. Why? Why is it focused, the light focused on him? Because do you think that man would have been healed if he didn't have faith in Jesus? No. So it's the power of the name of Jesus, but it's also that man's faith in that name. You get it? So those of you having problems, having issues, not just with your health, but with your husbands or wives, your marriages, or your children, or anybody else in your life that you're having problems with, who can make them healthy and well? In the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, rise up and walk. We can pray that prayer even though we have told that person 1,000 times, we love them, we want you to change, but they don't want to be changed. They don't want to be healthy in a relationship with God that's healthy. But we know there is power in the name of Jesus. Amen? I often, pray and cry out to the Lord, Lord, have mercy. Lord, heal. Heal those who are crying out for wellness in their lives. And I'm reminded, I'm going to do this, not because of you, but because of me and my power and authority to heal. You see, the story goes on. Jesus is exalted in these verses. Because Peter doesn't stop and say, you see this man? He was made healthy. You should know this, that the name of Jesus made him well. But more than this, what does Peter say in verse 12? And there is no salvation, or there is salvation in no one else. There is salvation in no one else. I would have put it, there is no salvation in anyone else. That's the more natural way of translating it, no? But the Greek is making that order important. Why is it important? Because when you change that around, there is no salvation in anyone else. Where is the emphasis? The emphasis usually is in the beginning, right? Whatever you say first is important. There is salvation. There is salvation. Salvation is important. By the way, salvation here doesn't only mean having eternal life. Baptists usually associate, oh, salvation, eternal life, I have that. No, salvation in the Bible can mean rescue. It can mean healing. It can mean deliverance from evil. It can mean the return of a loved one. That person has been saved, like the prodigal son. Salvation in no one else. There is salvation. Not all religions are the same. Not all religions are the same. In fact, Christianity is not a religion. It's a faith. It's not something you do to earn God's salvation. And so, God, you have to accept me. I've done all these things. Christianity is saying, Jesus did all this. Lord, be merciful and accept me because of what Christ has done for me. That's faith in Jesus. Just like the layman. The layman said, I believe in the name of Jesus. There is salvation for me because of Jesus. Not because I did something. I'm lame. Isn't it? What can you ask a layman to do? And especially with that picture there. We are all lame. We are all incapacitated, not able to move an arm or a leg or even to speak. But we can stare our Lord right in the face and say, I believe in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, and therefore I will be healed, and therefore I will be saved, and therefore my family will be saved. I've heard a lot of good news about families in this church lately. But I've also heard a lot of bad news. Is bad news bad? Well, you say, yes, it is. That's why it's called bad news, diba? To us, it may seem like bad news. But when you look at what God did to that lame man, the lame man is bad news. He asks for money in the temple courts. Go away. You're disrupting the peace. But that bad news turned into a good news. Jesus Christ of Nazareth healed him. The good news I've been hearing from you about your children doing well, your children being able to continue on with their studies, and the answered prayers you've been giving me about your health. They're good news, but there was bad news first, isn't it? And the bad news turned into good news. I'm not minimizing bad news. Bad news is bad. I mourn with you. I plead with God for turning those bad news into good news. But there are opportunities for God to come forward, to show up and say, God, this is your doing, not mine. Therefore, your name will be praised. Therefore, you will be honored. Because Peter said this at the end. There is salvation in no one else. For there is no other name under heaven given among people by which we must be saved. What about those people who are so sincere in their religion? You mean they're not going to be saved? You mean they're not going to be healed? Yes, the Lord may heal broken relationships, but all of that to show that it is from Him. If the people don't acknowledge that it's from Him, it's by His power, then they're not going to be saved. Because they usually think, praise science. Praise the doctor. Praise my own wisdom in doing this. And I was able to praise my friends who told me to do this. Praise, 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 praise. And God doesn't get the praise. There is no salvation under heaven. Please remember that. Even if you succeed in life, even if you have a PhD, I'm sorry to say, Sister Olive, I wanted a PhD. I guess it's too late for me now. Maybe one of my children can pursue that. Or one of my children's husband. So my point is this. I'm not knocking down achievements. You know, all of you have achieved something. You wouldn't be here if you didn't achieve something. If you can make it here in New York, what does it say? You can make it anywhere. Try Australia. No? I've seen people who go there and can't work. Work in Australia is very hard. Until you realize that work comes from God and you plead with God, God, give me work. I came from America to the Philippines. I had a master's degree and God did not give me work for 5 months. Or four. My wife usually corrects me in that. And I was struggling. I was saying to God, Lord, why did you bring me here? This God-forsaken land. You know? Well, I can't understand a word these people are talking. Makata, bata, wata. And I go, what's that? No? And the point is this. God showed me that He blesses me not through my own achievements. Not that I have a master's degree in Colorado for some mining engineering courses. Not because I am smart or because I have this or I have that. But because of His wonderful gift in Christ Jesus, my Lord. And the Holy Spirit is given me. My world is changed. We live in a changed world. Now listen to this. And I will close with these things. The question was, by what power or what name did you do this? And the answer was, by the name of Jesus Christ, whom God raised, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead. This man stands healthy before you. Before you fall asleep on me, let me tell you one more story. And I will end with a few application questions. When our kids were growing up, they made bad decisions, right? And who doesn't? Sometimes they listen to friends rather than us. Peter was warned by the Sadducees, the high priest, just don't talk about Jesus anymore. We're going to release you. What did Peter say? We would obey God rather than man. How bold is that? Peter, who denied the Lord Jesus Christ, no? Peter, who said, Lord, I will never leave you nor forsake you, and then he ran away. He cut off somebody's ear. He did all things. And denying the Lord is, of course, the most objectionable thing he's done. Peter said, we would rather obey God than man. Our girls, they listened to what their friends told them. Oh, so but so-and-so told me to do this. Is that a familiar line? Have you heard that before? Or did you actually do that before also as a parent? No, it wasn't me, Mom. I got into a fight because this guy, when you're playing marbles, you know, he cheated and he took my marbles away. Remember those stories? We blame somebody else. Not only that, we obey somebody else. No? Peter says, I would rather obey God than man. That's a big change in Peter. That's more than pleasing somebody I know, somebody I love, somebody I respect. Kids, high school kids, obey God rather than man. Do the right thing, not because your Facebook friend said, this is cool. You do the right thing because you know there's no other name, there's no other power to save you and to save the rest of your family, even to save your parents from going crazy. You know, when you keep blaming somebody else, your parents will say, what will I do, Pastor? No? Because their friends are more significant than you now, parents. You should know that. You should accept that. And that's why you need to pray. In the name of Jesus. You can't do anything about it. You stress over it, but you're losing in the battle. You will never win against their friends. You say something wrong about their friends, who's the enemy? Who's the enemy? Not their friends. You are. Because you're criticizing their friends. A little bit of parenting 101 perhaps, but still, it applies here. I used to do that too. But you know, friends, once we realize that Christ is who He is and what He has done, and that the world has changed, then choosing to please people rather than pleasing God is dumb. Is stupid. Is sin. and leads to problems. Not because you're morally right and upright and moralistically, you know, good, but because, you know, we are all sinners. We are still sinners, even though we became Christians. We're forgiven sinners. And we're so loved by God. But listen, that person talking to you is also a sinner, just like you. So let's sin together, is what they always say. Let's sin together. No? Romans 1 says that. But we, when you get together with other believers, let's sin and talk about somebody. Let's gossip. It's fun. No? Let's sin and bring somebody's reputation down. That's fun. But listen, the Bible says, don't sin together. Live together in this new world, the changed world. I would like to give you a few observations. I know my time isn't finished yet, but I'm giving you a lot this morning because this is a whole chapter. Look at verse 24, 30. Give me the background, right? Peter says we would obey God rather than men, right? Now, let me point out, and let me blank this out just in a while. We would obey God rather than man. So the Sadducees dismissed them. And they didn't want to incite problems with the people because many people believed in what they're saying. How many did it say? 5,000. Whether they got up to the number 5,000 or 5,000 was added, it's still a sizable number, right? So they wanted to be popular with the people, so they did not really arrest them anymore. They released them. If you read the whole chapter, you will notice that they went back to their friends. They went back to their friends. They were having a prayer meeting. They were praying for Peter and John while they were in prison. They were in the hearing. You get the story? And here's what they did. They prayed some more. They prayed some more, and it says there, by the way, the prayer is in your bulletin. Can you open that to that prayer, please? Open to that prayer, please. The call to worship this morning. Okay, let's read it together. Just like in our responsive reading. Ready? Go. Sovereign Lord. Louder, please. Let me continue in verse 31. What happened after they prayed? What happened after they prayed? When they had prayed, the place where they assembled together was shaken. I was hoping that this place would be shaken after you read that prayer. But it didn't happen. But I'm sure this will shake your heart. Because when the people of God are persecuted, especially by outsiders, we should pray. There are people who belong to this church and have left this church, and we consider them in some ways outsiders already. And if they threaten the life of this church, we should pray and ask that the life of the church will be preserved. Whether it be our young people or our older people. People who would like to emasculate this church, the church of our Lord Jesus Christ, should continue praying because the church of Christ is strong in the name of Jesus Christ. I realize that there may be times when you need to pray this prayer, because the Holy Spirit will then fill this place. What does it say? And they were all filled with the Holy Spirit and began to speak the word of God courageously. That's the result. Pray this prayer when you feel like giving up, because the sovereign Lord, despotas, where we get our word despot, huh? Ruler, dictator, God. Pastor, that doesn't make sense. Dictator, God. That sounds negative, doesn't it? But if there's anyone who has the right and the power to dictate, not those puny little politicians who say they will be dictators, whether here in America or in the Philippines, it's still God who is sovereign, who is dictator. He rules. And whether you're facing a problem in your health or with your family, with your marriages, with your relationships, this ruler God, the name of Jesus Christ, will continue to rule, and he will shake your world. No? And perhaps he's shaking your world now. You see, those people who remain, I'll talk about this next week, they continued on meeting together and sharing what they have with each other and giving to those in need. When's the last time you heard this? In Acts 2. It's repeated. And then, just to give you a preview, somebody sold their land and gave it to all in need. Much like perhaps a church I know in the West, they had a huge debt and they couldn't do ministry, so somebody donated money to pay off the debt, because they can now continue on with their ministry. You see, when we live in a changed world, we're going to spend time individually and as a church in prayer, asking for our sovereign God to open doors of opportunity for the gospel, whatever those doors may be. I want to close with this story, because I have been praying for my neighbor that I may be able to present the gospel to him. He came to me just the other month and said, Pastor, would you pray for us? Because my father-in-law has cancer. I have been praying for my neighbor, praying with him, that's what I meant, when he was going to get married, and that's when we first moved. He knows I'm a pastor. Pastor, please pray for me. Carolina and I are getting married next year. So I started praying for them. And I kept praying for them along the way. But last Saturday, was it Saturday? Friday. They invited us for a walk. They invited us after we had a walk to have barbecue with them. Started bringing out the corn and the cob and say, sit here, Pastor. And started bringing out the intestines, you know, and the pork skin. And Esau, no? Esau, like Esau, and pork skin and barbecue ribs. And I go, I'm sorry, but my arteries are beginning to complain. I think I will just have to, you know, not eat anymore. But he kept going and telling us about their father-in-law, his father-in-law, who has now been pronounced with stage 3 cancer and undergoing chemo and all sorts of things. His wife talked to my wife, and you see these opportunities? Because we prayed, and because God showed up, and in answer to prayer, we got those opportunities to share. See, you should look for opportunities as individuals and as a church, that the sovereign God will open up opportunities for you to talk to your children, perhaps, whose faith is dwindling, whose faith is not there as it was before, who probably has not been to church for a long time. You have to talk to them. I try, whenever I see them, to talk to them, but my influence is only limited. You, as parents, have a limitless amount of opportunities to encourage them. Make use of them. Secondly, are you alert to God's answers for prayers for the gospel opportunities? I hope you don't mind my saying this, but many times when we have affairs in this church and we realize that we need to bring our friends and our loved ones to church so they can hear those messages of the gospel, that's good. Just like Sister Ledlet invited her friends, and that's why I presented the gospel, Two Ways to Live. You remember that last week? And I said to them, this is what it means to follow Christ. That's good. But more than that, the people in your families need to hear the gospel all the time from you. Not just sermons about be a good kid, study well, do this, do that, right? They should keep hearing. You might fail in life, but God still can turn you around, just like Peter. You can live in a changed world and have a changed life. And how do we boldly seize opportunities to engage our family, friends, neighbors, and acquaintances with the gospel? Or are we too timid and say, I think I'll tell the pastor, talk to this guy, talk to my children. No, pastor, this is your job. No, that is not my job. It's your job. My job is to encourage you and train you on how you should do it. One of our visitors told me about the fact that he's trying to tell this person about the gospel. And he goes, Pastor, can you help me? How I can do this? And I gave him some links and some help. And I'm hoping he's doing it to be able to reach out. Now, when we face persecution, how do we respond? When somebody ridicules our faith, do you understand that if you are a changed person in a changed world, you will always be under persecution? You will always be singled out. You're weird. You still believe in Jesus? Person who lived 2,000 years ago? Carpenter's son? I heard that from Bart Simpson. In the Simpsons. No? Simpsons. You still believe in this Jesus? Died 2,000 years ago? Irrelevant. If only they knew the power of Christ and His authority. And lastly, our Lord was exceedingly gracious to Peter in giving him the opportunity to stand firm in his commitment after having denied our Lord Jesus Christ. Do you see yourself like Peter in recommitting your life to standing firm in your faith? Do you see yourself living in a changed world and being changed yourself? Because your life should never be the same after you have received Jesus Christ as your Lord and Savior, given your life to Him, and received the power of the Holy Spirit to fill you, to enable you to live in His name, in His authority, and in His power. Can I ask you all to stand up and let's pray. Our dear Heavenly Father, now that Jesus had died and risen, and we call on His name, and nobody else's, because nobody else can deliver us, can save us. We weep with those who weep. We mourn with those who mourn this morning, who seek the deliverance of Christ in their lives, the deliverance of a loved one, a child perhaps, or a parent, a wife or a husband. Father, we will never stop pleading with you. Lord, have mercy, and in the name of Jesus Christ, we pray that you will help them to repent and turn to you so that their sins may be wiped away and that the times of refreshing will come from you. That the Messiah, the Savior, will come into their life, our Lord Jesus Christ. Father, we have messed up really bad. We need to turn back to you. We need to recognize that all that we have and all that we are is a gift from your grace, a gift of grace that comes only for you. Father, we are too weak to live for Jesus. We are too incapacitated and lame. Lord, we don't want to drag around our guilt any longer and our shame. And the shame and guilt of those we love, because it pains our hearts. We ask, Father, that you would heal. You would make us whole and healthy again, because everything had changed once Jesus has come, and Jesus is Lord, and Jesus is at work in our world. Indeed, salvation belongs to Him alone. Help us to live so we know that the world has changed because Christ has come. Hallelujah. Praise and honor to your holy name. Holy Spirit, shake our world. Make us lame. Lame in spirit, because you have said, blessed are the poor in spirit, for they shall see God. And for those of us here who don't know the Lord Jesus Christ yet, we pray that you will continue to open their hearts and make yourself known to them so that salvation will come to them and they will receive forgiveness of their sin. We pray, Father, that this church will continue to do its mission of proclaiming boldly the name of Jesus Christ and obeying, submitting to you and not to man, to please you and not to please people. Because we know, Lord, when you are pleased, then we have been faithful and have obeyed and submitted ourselves to you. Father, be merciful. And now let me ask those who have special requests, whatever it is, thanksgiving and praises, or perhaps something that you'd like to pray for, to come forward. If the Holy Spirit has touched your lives this morning and you wish to recommit yourselves, you have failed God, you have gone after things of this world, you have followed your friends, and now you know that you have to follow God, please come forward and I'll pray for you. If you believe that there is salvation in no one else but the name of Jesus, I'll pray for you. If that is the desire of your heart, and you wish to commit a loved one to God and trust that God will do His work, come forward, please. And if there is weeping and sorrow, remember God's words. Weeping may last through the night, but joy, oh, what joy comes in the morning. This has been your experience all your life. Sorrow and joy. A day will come when Christ will call you back to Himself and you will have to give account. Don't you want to be able to say, Lord, on account of the Lord Jesus Christ and what He's done in my life to change me, I live in a changed world, and you have enabled me by your Spirit to live out that change. Please come forward. This is the prayer of your heart. Nothing else will do. Only Jesus. We say that, we sing it, and we pray for it now. Father, and as the whole church raises your hands towards His people who are in front, our brethren. As you commit our brethren to your hands, knowing that they have needs that only God can meet. And if you feel compelled to come forward and place your hand on any one of our brothers and sisters who are in front, if you feel compelled to come forward and lay your hands so that they will feel your support, they will feel your love for them, please come forward and put your hand. Over these, our brethren. This is church. This is what the Spirit of God does to people who are in need. That we share with them in their needs. And I'd like you to all pray individually, not just for people in front, although that is what I asked for. You pray for them. Or maybe even the person next to you who did not come forward and needing your prayers. You know what they need. You know the sorrow in their hearts. You know the pain that they bear. And most of all, God knows. And if your prayer is for healing physically, we believe that in the name of Jesus, there is power and there's authority to heal. And would you come forward, please, because you want to experience and continue to experience that healing that comes from Him alone. Make this a desire of your heart all through this week. I know we're taking a bit of time, we're waiting for the Spirit talking to each one and committing yourselves to God. Have you prayed? Have you prayed for the person who are in front? Or at least one? Have you prayed for somebody next to you who might be in need? Put your hand over that person if you have to. Pray for each other that God's wisdom will help you raise your family. That you will be in agreement as husband and wife on how you should raise your children. And maybe even in disagreement, but you choose to disagree and yet depend on God and be at peace with each other. And perhaps you need to be prayed for so that your life will be turned around and have joy in your heart instead of sorrow and pain. Let's pray. Thank you for the way your Spirit is moving in our midst. Touching each person's life so that our heartaches are turned over to you. Whatever it is that aches our bodies, Lord, we commit them to you. Because you can make us healthy and well. More so when our Lord Jesus Christ returns and you give us a glorified body. Immortal, imperishable, eternal. Father, we commit to you this church, each and every member here, supporting and loving each other and sinning no more. Not encouraging each other to sin. Yes, we are still sinners, Father. But may we, when found together in this place, live for you and not for ourselves. Live for each other and not for ourselves. Live as changed individuals because the Spirit lives in us. Renew us. Change us, we pray. In Jesus' mighty name, we pray. Amen and amen.